In this edition of Art Loft, we meet at the crossroads where vanity, death, and fashion intersect.
There's this thing where you can decorate death.
The beauty of strangers on the subways of New York.
I approached these people and asked them, may I do your video portrait? And to my surprise, most of them said, okay.
The struggles a Marine must confront after returning home from war.
What he did was an act of valor, and it really makes you question, you know, what that can do to somebody's psyche.
Learn how Jews put the rock in rock and roll.
It's basically a musical history tour, if you will, looking at over 60 years of Jews in rock and roll.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show, and every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from the set of Hedda Gabler at O Cinema Miami Shores, this is Art Loft. The fashion world has always encouraged a certain level of vanity. But what happens when fashion holds up the mirror and begins to question death? At the Bass Art Museum, Harold Cota shows viewers the Vanitas exhibit and what happens when death and fashion collide with fine art.
Harold Cota, curator in charge of the Costume Institute at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and I'm a consulting curator here at the Bass Museum. The Bass Museum is hosting an exhibition called Vanitas, Fashion and Art, which is one of the first, I believe, exhibitions here that focuses on actual apparel. Vanitas, the title of the exhibition, is really derived from 17th century Dutch still lives. Vanitas, vanitatum, omnia vanitas was an exhortation in the Bible about the ephemerality of life and worldly pursuit. So it's vanity, vanity, all is vanity. Physical beauty at its peak, but poised on the point of its slipping into rot. One of the first things that the public will see is an Iris van Herpen dress that it alludes to Vanitas themes without actually being about Vanitas. The designer skydives, and she says when she's in free fall, she feels such a sense of liberation and freedom that she wanted somehow to encapsulate that in a garment. And so what she's done is perhaps counterintuitive. She's created a skeleton to put over the body as a way to suggest the liberation of the spirit. It's about freedom. There's a spectacular Sarah Burton dress. You see a mannequin that is floating up off the ground wearing one of her butterfly dresses. And it's as if a swarm of butterflies has created an armor over this woman. So there you see the butterfly, which is seen as something that is, you know, fragile, beautiful, but quick to die, incorporated in a way that doesn't focus on those darker themes, yet holds them, and is presented in a way that is aestheticizing. You know, what I love about Miami and Miami Beach is that it's this intersections of so many cultures, but it's especially the Latino culture that infuses this whole environment. And I think that a Vanitas exhibition as a spring show, you know, spring, rejuvenation, happiness, it's not really logical for most places. But within Spanish culture, there's this thing where you can decorate death. And so it seems like to have a spring show of Vanitas is not inappropriate in a culture which isn't afraid of addressing death as an issue, mortality as an issue, that it's something that has to do with resurrection, rejuvenation, as much as it has to do with loss. And Vanitas is not a logical subject for fashion. Fashion is about optimism, looking to the future, capturing desire and seduction, luxury. You can look at the fine art pieces and say, you know, even these themes can percolate into the field that's seen as superficial as fashion, that even these richer narratives can also abide in something like a spring dress.
For more about Vanitas and current exhibitions at the Bass Art Museum, visit bassmuseum.org.
There's a great challenge when you're playing a multiple roles to give each character his or her own voice.
How would you respond to the question, what do you like about yourself? Video artist Cat Del Buono encapsulates the best qualities of New York City's subway passengers in her exhibit, Riders on the Four.
My name is Cat Del Buono, and I am a video artist. The video installation is called Next Stop Wynwood, which is actually based on another project that I had started a few years back called Riders on the Four. If you went into the gallery space, you would have seen the two monitors, which had actual subway riders just sitting there. What I had done was their video portrait. And in the background of the two video monitors, you would see a projection of a platform of a subway to kind of put you in the environment of being there in the subway, experiencing what the rest of us commuters would experience if you were on the subway. The way it had started was I approached these people and asked them, may I do your video portrait? And to my surprise, most of them said, okay. So I just filmed them sitting there, so you don't see them talking or anything. But then after, I said, now can you tell me something that you like about yourself?
Everything. I'm an artist, I'm a writer, I have my own CDs.
So I took that audio and put it underneath the image of them just sitting there. So you have your video portrait with the sound of the actual person talking about themselves. And the reason why I chose the question, I wanted to have the same question for everybody. Tell me something you like about yourself. Was at the time I was like watching reruns of Nip Tuck, and I don't know if you ever watched it, but the guys always asked, tell me something you don't like about yourself. And I wanted to do the opposite, because I never liked that question. And to keep some sort of conformity there, I wanted everybody to have the same question. That was the question I posed for them.
I think I'm pretty charming, smart, hard worker.
When you're sitting on the subway and you start looking at people, you start, you know, guessing who they might be. Or you might see something that's attractive to you in some way, whether it's a physicality or something unique or something. And that's how I chose my person. There was something about them that attracted me. It ended up being, you know, all different colors, ages, types, because that's what you get on a New York City subway. And that's what I love about New York is the diversity. So that's how the project ended up being as well.
For more information on Cat Del Buono, visit her website at catdelbuono.com.
I think a lot of people are surprised, will be surprised, just by simply recognizing that some of these artists are Jewish.
The traumas of war often leave soldiers with physical and mental scars. But what happens when returning home reopens those scars and etches them in anew? The play Fear Up Harsh depicts some of the harsh realities a soldier faces when returning home from war.
Fear Up Harsh is about a United States Medal of Honor winner who has come back from the war and become quite prosperous as a result of winning the Medal of Honor. And he gets a visit from a former colleague from the Iraq War who comes to beg him for a favor that only he can provide for her. And it's about how either granting that favor or not will affect his life.
There's been an incident years in the past when he was in combat on a tour of combat duty in Iraq, and now he's confined. The lower half of his body, you know, isn't functioning, so he's confined to a wheelchair. And he's been praised for his actions, you know, in the line of combat, which, you know, led to his injury, but also throughout the course of the play, it's not as easy as what he did was an act of valor. There are other things involved, and it really makes you question the power of recognition, the power of awards, and the accolades you receive from your peers and from everybody else around you, and, you know, what that can do to somebody's psyche, or what they're able to forgive about themselves, you know. So it's a traumatic physical injury, but the emotional ramifications are just as severe.
Shane plays the Medal of Honor recipient, and Shane actually is the actor, and he actually was a member of the U.S. Army on active duty in, I believe, in Desert Storm, or during Desert Storm. When we first meet his character, he is this kind of stalwart, typical picture of a hero, big, tall, good-looking, blonde, all-American guy. And what we learn is that he has suffered from some of the same problems that everybody does, even though his persona has been touched up and spackled over so that we only see the prettified version of him.
Pentagon likes to have us PR folk look it over, make sure that the optics are...
Steve actually has the extraordinarily difficult task of playing about six different people in the play, three or four of whom are people up the chain of command in the military. So he plays a captain, a colonel, and a general in reverse order in the play.
There's a great challenge when you're playing multiple roles to give each character his or her own voice. And I say his or her because in the past I have played both male and female characters in the same play. Another challenge altogether. But to give the character his or her own voice, his or her own physical characteristics, whether it be a walk or a way of carrying oneself. And it's not unlike the process of learning a single character, but you're doing it over a broader map. So every one of my scenes I think of as its own little play. So I'm playing, you know, seven, eight different shows here.
Fear Up Harsh is a term that was in the U.S. Army manual, and it referred to one type of interrogation that was permitted. There were a number of very colorful names, I think, for interrogation techniques. One was ego up harsh, fear up, just fear up, and fear up harsh being the most, I guess, severe version. And Fear Up Harsh was famously the type of interrogation that was, I guess, certain people took license with and turned into torture at Abu Ghraib and other places.
I would never want somebody to come here and say, let me see how you're representing me. And I hope that the audience doesn't feel that this is us telling the real story of the Marine Corps. That's not our purpose here. Our purpose here is more human, using that as a backdrop for a human story.
For more information about Fear Up Harsh and current performances at the Adrian Arsh Center, visit archcenter.org.
The wonderful thing about classical ballet training is it prepares a child for any career they pursue because it teaches them discipline, self-esteem, an incredible work ethic.
Up next, we stop by Milwaukee's Jewish Museum, where its Jews Who Rock exhibit is something of a who's who of rock and roll history. From music legends like Bob Dylan to more contemporary pop stars like Pink, the exhibit reveals the range and magnitude of the Jewish contribution to American music. So, are you ready to rock?
A lot of people are surprised, will be surprised, just by simply recognizing that some of these artists are Jewish. People walk into this room and they just are excited by it and they're lit up by it. It's a positive energy room and people are really taking that away with them and spreading the buzz in the community, which we love. This is called Jews Who Rock, and it's basically a musical history tour, if you will, looking at over 60 years of Jews in rock and roll. We selected images and panels and customized it specifically for the Jewish Museum Milwaukee space.
One of the things that I think this exhibit does is it really shows the breadth of Jewish belief and practice, that you have, generally when we're talking about Jews, you have a more formal religious kind of impression of them. In this exhibit, you see Jews who are secular, who are cultural, who, you know, have Jewish parentage but don't really practice much in terms of religious practice through these famous personas. And to me, that's a really, really interesting part of this exhibit.
You've got rare photographs, you've got certainly biographical text panels and labels, some compilation pieces with different CDs, cassette tapes, photographs. We've got books, we've got albums, we've got Kiss action figures, what could be better? So we have a little bit of everything.
The idea is actually to present something that is not typically thought of being a Jewish topic. Jews who rock is not necessarily something you would think. Jews who rock, question mark. And so the thought was, what can we do that's really different? Whether it's the rock and rollers themselves who are Jewish, who nobody thinks about, whether it's Pink or Drake, or is it actually something more than that, than the fact there is Jews behind the scenes, or the origin of Jews who rock, whether it's the Gershwins or the, you know, that the idea of what the music scene was, producers, directors, and the like as well.
The other thing I always like to do is to augment with local artifacts, so it does have that community connection. And so we were lucky enough to be able to work with some families in our community who have ties to the Jewish rock world or who are avid collectors of artifacts that pertain to rock and roll, and who loaned us some of those pieces to help us really round out the exhibit. One of the local pieces that we have that really is rather exciting is a Moog Mini Voyager synthesizer. And this was loaned to us by a local music producer by the name of Michael Kohler. He works with a lot of big names all around the country and the world. And Bob Moog is the founder and inventor of the synthesizer, the Moog synthesizer. And this was something that revolutionized the rock and roll and music business way beyond Phil Spector's Wall of Sound.
Without this technology, the sound of music today would be totally different, for better or for worse, you know. Pretty much anything on popular radio has some sort of synth component.
Actually, 2014 marks the 50th anniversary of the Moog Mini Voyager. It really was a game changer. One of the other families we were lucky enough to work with is the Epstein family, and they are relatives of Howie Epstein, who was the primary bass player for Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers for years and years. He grew up here in Milwaukee, graduated from Nicolet High School, and unfortunately, kind of a cautionary tale, got caught up in the rock and roll lifestyle, but the family was kind enough to loan us some significant items, including a collector's edition Redwood Clover and Sandburg bass guitar that is in our atrium case. We have his graduation picture from the Nicolet Shield yearbook and some great historical information. So that really made a wonderful addition. People will be surprised by the people that we have represented and not having recognized that they were Jewish. So people like Gene Simmons, who was born Chaim Witz in Haifa, Israel, and with Paul Stanley, who was two of the co-founders of the rock group, the metal group Kiss. A lot of people don't know that about Gene Simmons. They don't know that he was born with a very Jewish name, that he was born in Israel.
There are the Bette Midlers that are there. There are the Barbra Streisands that are there. Those are the obvious ones, but then there's some others that are kind of, wow, I didn't know that drummer was. I didn't know that lead guitarist was. And that's fun to see.
We partnered with 53rd Street School through a program called Arts at Large. 53rd Street School is this school that has so many questions about Jews and Jewish people, and we spent a lot of time on Jewish identity and who are the Jews. Then they went back to their school and worked in teams, and they picked four contemporary artists. They focused on Pink, Mac Miller, Drake, and Adam Levine from Maroon 5. They created these beautiful records, and they actually took records and record album covers and created collages and pieces to kind of represent the artists that they were working with. And it's such a lovely kind of entryway into the gallery.
another way of engaging some of the younger demographic was the idea to put together a playlist, a Juicy Rock playlist. So through Spotify, we've put together this list, and we kind of have a listening and looking corner where you can sit down, and Koss, who was one of our supporters, was kind enough to donate some wonderful earphones. You can sit down, you can put on the headphones, you can listen to some of the artists. Everyone is represented, and many beyond who are represented are here. It's a nice interactive corner that you can come and listen as well as look. One of the things I want people to take away is to understand the relevance of Jewish individuals to the rock genre and how they've been such an important factor in the growth and development of that industry. I think it's important to recognize that music is very much a part of Jewish culture and heritage and has been since antiquity. The Jewish people are known as the people of the book or the written word versus the image. So when you think about what role words and lyrics play in the development of music, it's a natural connection. So to be able to make those ties historically and to be able to look at, you know, consistently throughout time, the role that Jewish individuals and communities have played in music and specifically in the development of the rock genre, I think that's an important lesson for our community, and not just the Jewish community, but the greater community, to be able to walk away with.
It's not just the, you know, the lead singers and the guitarists and the bassists and the drummers that make up music, but it's the people in the background, the people who are producing, the people who are doing things like coming up with new music technology that really have impacted our way of listening to music.
I like the idea that we can not necessarily talk about doom and gloom Judaism. That's a lot of Jewish history. It's a pretty cool thing to sometimes have something that's just really fun to celebrate and fun to just simply enjoy what you're celebrating. And that's what the show really, really is. It's just a phenomenal display of, wow, look what we did. Look a contribution we made.
For more information about exhibits at the Milwaukee Jewish Museum, visit jewishmuseummilwaukee.org. Thanks so much for joining us this week. Remember, you can always visit wpbt2.org/artloft to watch past episodes. And also, follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. I'm Kalyn James, reminding you to stay creative. Bye. Three, two, Rizzy. What? I could hit you with this. No, I should be like, this is Art Loft. Yeah. More about Vanitas and current exhibitions. I don't like current. From musical legends like Bob Dylan to Pink. I didn't know Pink was Jewish. Oh, I'm not saying my N, so that I was like, when we're returning. Did you watch me? I think I'm blinking my eyes a lot. And magnitude of the Jewish contribution to American music. Are you ready to rock? I was like, we are art. And Rico was like, really? Wow. Artcenter.org.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation. Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.